Well, we started with the good news, right? This morning started with so many good news. Well, happy Easter, everyone, once again. Out of all days, out of all Sundays, today would be day to celebrate, to remember why we can celebrate. You know, we can celebrate, we can get happy, but today is sort of like the day, well, like this is the reason why we're so happy, why we're shouting, why are we so just enjoying ourselves in the presence of God? Because we have hope. Jesus is the reason for our celebration. It is confirmed, he is dead. You know, Romans really knew how to prove that and verify that person was really dead. Jesus was pronounced dead on that day. Hope was lost. His followers were scattered, but Jesus was just getting started to launch his ministry. He is risen. No death could hold him. And more than that, on the day of his resurrection, when he died, death was defeated. It was defeated. It has no hold on Jesus. And the Bible says he has no hold on those who believe him. He rose to live again. And that is our hope. Our life doesn't just end in the casket, but we have been promised eternal life by the person who predicted he will die and predicted he will resurrect again. He will rise again. And he did rise again. So we believe in the one whose promises are true. The guards were sent to watch his tomb. It never happened before and never happened after. The guards were watching and guarding his tomb in case somebody will steal his body, in case someone will claim that he is resurrected. But Jesus could not be held by any guards, by anything else, because he was resurrected by the power of God. And more than that, more than 500 people saw him after he was rose from the dead. And many of them wrote their story of encounter with resurrected Jesus. So we have a lot of witnesses, as Bible said. So today we talk about Jesus. He's the center of the message of Easter. Easter means the tomb is empty, but our heart is full. Heart is full of hope and love and a promise. Jesus came to this earth with mission. Easter is the time when mission was accomplished. You remember the signs. You remember when the troops come home, they say, mission accomplished. Jesus' mission was accomplished, was done. Now was time. Easter is the time when it was done. And then he told his disciples, his followers, he says, now I received all the authority in heaven and on earth. But then he didn't say, I'm going to go and do the mission. And then he says to his disciples, now you go. So Jesus done his part, and then he says, now you go. When Jesus was around, he did not travel far, but he sent us to go. You know, the furthest Jesus traveled was 400 miles. I know that some of you traveled the world. You've been around. You know places. But Jesus only traveled 400 miles from the place of his birth, and even that was because his family was escaping Herod, the psychotic king who was trying to kill Jesus, a little baby. And many baby boys were killed when Herod was pursuing to find and kill Jesus. Now, his disciples took message of resurrection to many nations, and we are still taking his message to our community and beyond. Now, talking about travel, when the Bible says take gospel to the ends of the earth, how many of you like to travel? How many of you like to travel? You just enjoy traveling. But now, how many of you are married to a person who just hates traveling? There are few. Well, I'm one of them. And I believe if God appeared to me and said, go to Africa and take your wife, it would not happen. Because Nadia just does not enjoy flying. She likes to travel, but as long as she can go there on the car, you know. No boat either. It's just car. She trusts those cars. So why? I know that between you and your destination, whenever you plan to travel, whenever you plan to do something, there is something in between. There are airports. There are nowadays fear of terrorism. There are long lines. Many things could happen to you when you travel. So when Jesus told his disciples, you go, it's traveling involved. And you know, when it comes to me, I don't have good record for traveling, especially from Springfield. My friends know that whenever I have a flight booked from Springfield, should be easy, no driving to Kansas City or anywhere. The plane would be late, it would be canceled, the bad weather, anything can happen. So just be prepared for anything to happen during your travel. But now, take it from me as experienced traveler. I enjoyed traveling. Before I was married, that's when I really traveled. I traveled all over the world. I've been to places, I've seen places. I went to mission, to Central Asia and other places. And take advice from me. When you travel, just pack light. This year, me and Nadia go to a tropical vacation after 9 years. And you would say, wow, how do you know it's been 9 years? You know, when you're married and you have kids, you measure everything, how old your kids are, right? They're like, we were there last time, and Nadia was pregnant with Heidi. And Heidi's almost nine. So at least 9 years. So you know it's been that long ago. So whenever you travel, be patient. Be ready to wait in those lines. Just grab a book, whatever takes your travel easier, whatever takes it easier. But let's talk about baggage. You need to bring your luggage, or today's word is baggage. Word of today's baggage. We already saw it twice in our videos. So we come to Mexico, and it's warm and nice, and Nadia brings 6 pairs of shoes. And that's scaled down for previous traveling. You're like, why? Well, just in case. You never know. You never know, just in case. So, and it just, the longer you travel, the more stuff you need. And what happens in our lives, the more we go through our lives, the more things we can accumulate. Some of them we need, but some of them just pulling us back. They're heavy. Maybe it is the time for us to realize that some of what we carry came along with our family heritage. We didn't bring it. It just came, the family tradition, the family problem, family fights, family bad habits, whatever it may be. It came with the family, so you're carrying it. But maybe some of it you picked up along the way. Today would be the great day just to get rid of it. Say, Lord, today I'm deciding to leave some of the baggage behind. I don't need the heaviness. I don't need the burden, even if it was brought by my family and I hold them dear and near to my heart. Today, I'm going to cut that off. It's not helping me. It's hurting me in my walk with you. So maybe it's time to get rid of that and say, I can't get past through some things that hold me back. I need to get through it. But let's go back to our story. Jesus came to earth pretty much because of events known to us as Easter. How many of you know when Jesus was on the cross, he said, it is finished. What is finished? His mission. The reason he came to this earth was done. It's finished. Sins are forgiven. But he had more in mind than just to do the mission. Now, what happens when he leaves? Jesus had to build a team. How many of you know if you're in business or you're in sports, that building your team is priority number one? If you don't have your team, you're going to be tired really quickly. So building a team was a big priority for Jesus. But Jesus had to find a group of locals. It would have been so much easier if Jesus brought like a legion of angels, supernatural beings with 6 wings, like Bible describes some of them. Everything would be done so much quicker, wouldn't it be? But now Jesus had to find locals to be his confidants. Locals were the people that he was going to trust his ministry when he leaves. And because Jesus had more in mind than just to do the mission, people were his mission. So Jesus brings the team, and let me tell you this. If you're going out of state, if you're going to Olympics, and they tell you, you can go, but the rules are you don't get to bring your players. That would kind of make things tough, right? So here Jesus comes to the earth, and people that he's choosing to be his disciples are just regular people. They're no extraordinary. They're not even educated that well. Some of them are, some of them are not. So Jesus picks a crowd of people, his followers, his disciples, that he's going to leave the mission just to regular people. So when the righteous people, the elite of those days, they find out Jesus just chose a regular people to be his disciples, because now they believe he's the Messiah. They see his powers. They don't believe he's the Messiah, but they cannot deny that he's a special person. He has power to do miracles. He's healing people. Two things they're just really taken back by. First, he's hanging out with sinners. That just was not thing to do if you're the righteous person. If you're a leader, if you are a spiritual leader, if you're a rabbi, you don't hang out with sinful people. And the second thing, even more outrageous, he wasn't making them follow religious rules. They're like, what? Jesus, first you hang out with sinners and then you don't tell them to repent. You don't tell them to follow our rules. What's happening? You know what's really happened? Because Jesus was and still is more interested in building a relationship with you than have you to follow the rules without knowing him personally. That's the big thing. If Jesus doesn't have your heart, if he doesn't have your attention, he doesn't want you or me following the rules, because rules will only make our life miserable. Today, I want to introduce you to four of his closest friends. Whenever we talk about Jesus' friends, I want to show you today that they were just regular people. So I want to introduce you to four, and as you sit there and listen, I want you to connect at least with one of them. If you connect with more, I'm not sure, maybe it's, you know, multiple personalities somewhere there, but at least you can relate to one of them and say, hey, that sounds like me right there. And to know that that person was Jesus' friend would be comforting for you and for me to know that Jesus chose that kind of person to be his friend. Let me introduce the person named James, the brother of Jesus. Now, James obviously was half-brother, because we know that Jesus was born from a virgin. There was no father, earthly father involved. So James was half-brother of Jesus, and I call him the church kid. We first learn about James from the Gospels. Then we read about him in the book of Acts. Later, James authored a book of James, a letter he wrote to believers of Jewish descent who started to believe in Jesus as their Messiah. So James grew up in church. How many of you church kids are here? Church kids. How many of you are PKs? There are a few. You know what's a PK? See, you don't know. Pastor's kid. If you're a pastor's kid, then you know the stories. You can relate. Like, oh, I know the stories. You know, they're good. Some of them bad. Some of them really ugly. Why? Because there are people involved. Whenever there's people, there's going to be mess. People are messy. We all have mess in our lives. And so James was the church kid. He grew up in church. He grew up with Jesus. Imagine that, growing up in one household with Jesus. But interesting thing is, James did not believe in Jesus as Lord until after the resurrection. So until the resurrection, James, like, one day, maybe. I can't deny miracles. I can't deny his kind heart. He's just different. But after the resurrection, James, like, okay, here's the Messiah. In 1 Corinthians 5:17, Paul writes that Jesus appeared to Peter and then to 12 apostles and then to more than 500 men. And then he says personally, Jesus appeared to James, this same James. We don't know what took place, but something in that meeting that Jesus had with James. James was convinced, this is not only my half-brother, this is the Messiah of the world. He's the King. He's the Lord. And then he called him the Lord and Savior. Next person I want to introduce you is Mary Magdalene, and I call her the sinner. How many of you can relate? Yeah. I am the sinner. I'm not proud of my past. I'm not proud maybe of my present. I can't boast that I never sinned, that I never made wrong choices. I think everyone is in that category. It just degree of our sinfulness may be different, but we all have sinned. We all have made wrong choices that we regretted, some choices that we cannot be proud of.
So, who was Mary? two of the meanings of her name in Hebrew is rebellion and bitter. That's not a good name, right? When parents name you, they're like, okay, rebellious. Maybe they tell you, you're so rebellious. But they will not name you that. They will name you a pretty name, like a marigold or something, you know, like some really pretty. But her name meant rebellion and bitter. Most Bible scholars agree that her past was not good. Whether she was a prostitute or just a sinful woman is unclear. One thing is true, and there is no disagreement, that she was the Mary who had 7 demons cast out of her by Jesus. What are demons? What do they represent? In Luke chapter 8, verses 1 and 2, the Bible tells us that she had demons. Demons are life-controlling issues in your life. Demons don't come to your life just to hang out with you, make friends. They're there to control, to torment, to make your life miserable. So Mary had her life just taken over by demons. She was controlled by lust, by sin, whatever she was. Some Bible scholars believe that the lady who washed Jesus' feet and poured anointing oil, fragrant oil on his feet, was the same Mary of Magdala. But we don't know about that for sure. But one thing is true, that she was not just a street girl. She was not. The Bible says that in our days, probably, she would be like a high-priced call girl. The Bible says that whenever she was cleansed by Jesus, whenever her life-controlling issues were taken care of, she became one of the sponsors of Jesus' ministry. She was wealthy. She had means. And with other ladies, one of them who's connected to governors of Judea home, she's working inside of his home. She's a person of influence, and now she starts to follow Jesus. Her life was bitter and without meaning. Even with multiple relationships, she felt alone and not loved. Some say, like I said, that she was the woman who came and she just started washing Jesus' feet with tears and wiping with their hair because she finally found a man who loved her, who set her free and wanted nothing in return. She found the true love. Let me tell you something. If you struggled with church, do not blame Jesus. If you've been put down by church people, do not blame Jesus. Jesus is nothing of a sort. Whenever he touches your life, he sets you free from your life-controlling issues, and he wants to see you grow, flourish, prosper, and he wants nothing in return. No strings attached. If you want to follow him, he says, you will find freedom, but he will make you choose your way. Jesus has overlooked her past. How many of you would like that about Jesus? Jesus will not always remind you of your past. He doesn't say, look back, that I'm not proud of. You already know what it is. So Jesus overlooks her past, and priests or spiritual leaders were not even supposed to have women, their friends, as friends. They were not supposed to, but Jesus was not concerned about that. He even wasn't concerned about his own reputation. How many of you know that people of influence care about their reputation? Maybe they want to be involved with somebody. Maybe they want to help, but they think 2 steps ahead. How is it going to look on me? So maybe I do want to help this person, but this is just not going to look on my resume, my association with this kind of people. Jesus, look, this person, just one person, for the good of many, why bother with this sinner? But you know what Jesus said? When people came to him and said, what would other churches say if you start inviting this kind of people to your church, to your congregation? Jesus, what would they say? Jesus did not care. Jesus said, I want you to follow me. Jesus was hanging out with sinners. That's why we don't care, whatever your past may be, because Jesus did not care. He wasn't there to pick on her past. He wasn't there to show her her future. If she follows him, we won't try to fix your past. We will just help you to move in the future that Jesus has for you. Amen. So Mary, the sinner, represents a person who has not the best past.
cannot be proud of his past, but I can guarantee you, Jesus will set you free. He will put you on a path of victory in your life. Next, John, the nice guy. How many of you can really, really, I'm a nice guy. I'm not rough, I'm not tough, I'm not hurting anybody. I'm just a nice guy. Leave me alone already. I'm a nice guy. But now, Jesus loved nice guys too. And I can't help but relate to a nice guy myself. I'm a nice guy. If you don't bother me, I will never bother you. So John was the nice guy. He was a disciple of Jesus. His brother James, not James, the Jesus' brother, another James. James was a very common name in the Bible. He was a fisherman before Jesus called him to ministry. And he's always mentioned last after his brother James. So he probably was younger brother. He was nice and younger. That doesn't always help. So he did not look for a spotlight, but a relationship. You know, when I studied about John, he was the guy who, whenever something important happened, he was there. But not because he was running there. He was just wanted to be near Jesus. He just wanted to be accepted. He wanted to be helpful. So he was always there with Jesus, but he never sought attention. You know how he referred to himself? He said, the person who Jesus loved. Isn't that nice? When you talk about yourself, hey, I'm the person who my wife loves. He said, Jesus loves me. I know that Jesus loved everybody. He even loved Judas. But somehow he made John feel like he was really loved. He was the person of relationship. He wasn't looking for position. He stayed there when Jesus died. All of the disciples ran away. He was the one who just stood there and watched Jesus be crucified and dead. And then Jesus tells John, take care of my mom. I don't know. We still don't know why when Mary had her other kids. Why Jesus said that to Mary, we don't know. Later he writes 5 books of the New Testament, and all of them are just filled with love instructions. He says to believers, love one another. Love one another. That's how people in the world will know you're Jesus' disciples, if you love one another. He was the person of relationship. He was the only one who Bible says, or tradition says, was not murdered for his faith, but died a natural death. And the last one I want to introduce you is Peter. Now, this guy, he's the leader. He's the brave guy. He's the risk taker. Without a doubt, he's the most famous apostle, right? Everybody knows who Peter. Like, maybe Bartholomew, we're like, oh, was he a disciple? Yeah, he's there. But nobody knows about him. But everybody knows when we talk about disciples. Peter, John, Andrew, we know all of those. Maybe from Sunday school. This guy, he was the center of attention. He's daring. He's challenging. Of course, he will stand up for Jesus. He certainly didn't want to come off as unsure of himself or lacking self-esteem. How many of you know those kind of guys? He's not lacking self-esteem. He knows everything. And I had experience with few of those in my life. And I was in construction business before when I lived in Washington State. And so here I need help. I was in cabinetry business. I need help. So what do you do when you need help? You ask around, like, do you know anybody who wants to work, who knows the job, because I don't have time to train. So he comes, this young guy, and he says, I've done it all. I know for sure. I know how to do it. So give me a layout. So I give him layout, and since he knows everything, we'll just go, like, you know, briefly, okay, here, this and that, and I leave. And then I come back, and I'm like, wow, I don't even know where to start. Like, really? And because he told me he knows everything. So, and those of you who know construction, he put crown upside down. That's a big one. And just a classic crown, not some kind of fancy, just a classic regular crown. He puts it upside down. So, and I'm like, Alex, why didn't you tell me you didn't know? He's like, you know, I just felt bad. I told you I know everything. So, you know, Peter was that kind of guy. Remember, he's like, Jesus, I want to walk on water. Jesus like, yeah, come on, go. And then he starts sinking. Jesus, help me. Remember at the last time when Jesus was with his disciples, here comes the army. And Peter just starts swinging his sword. He's not sure what's going to come out of it. He hits somebody over the head. He cuts their ear off. He doesn't think ahead. He's just in the moment. He's making things happen. So, and pass forward, what happened to him? He finds himself denying Christ three times. He finds himself going back to fishing. He finds himself struggling with the thought that God will ever forgive him because he just denied him in front of people, in front of everything. But you know what is really worth noting in this story and this friend of Jesus, Peter? Jesus never gives up on people. Jesus never gives up on people. When Jesus rose from the dead, he sent a personal message to Peter. He did not have SMS or email. He sends a person. He sends Mary. He says, go tell my disciples and tell Peter, personal message. I am waiting for him. I am not done with him. I am not done with him. Jesus is not making a mistake by choosing you. You look at some of the disciples, what they've done before Day of Pentecost, before they really received understanding of who Jesus was, and you're thinking, Jesus, what was the plan with these people? Let me tell you, even on the days when you feel like you failed God, he is not disappointed in you because he is not done with you. He is not done with you. Your failure may be just a start to what about to begin. You have trained, you prepared yourself, you have studied, but now real starts, real life starts, real steps you need to take in ministry, in life, and you fail, and you will fail. Because theory is one thing when you know everything. You know how many of you went to college or to school and you know like everything, but then you go to work, you go start finding a job, and you find out that you don't know anything. You have to start from scratch. You have to learn little by little, and people who didn't go to college but have practical experience all of a sudden look like geniuses to you because they know everything by doing it. So whenever you start ministry, don't get disappointed, or you start marriage, start business, whatever you're in, don't get disappointed if you fail from your first try. Keep on trying. So God tells Peter, I'm not done with you. You will fall, but he's not disappointed in you, disappointed. God knows beginning and God knows the end, but we only see now. That's why we get disappointed. So here's what I want to tell you. Just don't give up on Jesus. He will never give up on you. Even if you turn your back towards him, he will never give up on you. So let me bring this all to a close. The topic today is the redemption. And you say, so where is the redemption in all of you that you speak? Where is the redemption? Where is grace? I thought today was Easter service. Let's hear from all of the friends of Jesus. I want you to hear from them what made the difference in their lives. What made the difference in their lives? I want you to hear from them saying in their own words how they lived such committed life to Jesus, and pretty much all of them gave their life for him. What has happened? What made a difference? They were ready to lay their lives. It's grace. It's redemption. They receive unmerited, undeserving favor from God in person of Jesus. Their lives were never the same. And here's what they say. James, from a skeptic to a believer, starting his letter to Jewish believers, he says, James, a servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. James, who was half-brother of Jesus, he never mentions that Jesus is his half-brother. He never mentions that he's the leader of the first church in Jerusalem, even though he was not disciple of Jesus. He said, James, the servant of Lord Jesus Christ. You know what Christ means? Christ means anointed, and Jesus means the Messiah, the sent one, Lord will save. So he says, I am the servant of the one who was sent, and he's my Messiah. He says, my sins were forgiven. He received Jesus, and that's all that made difference. And then he writes to church in Jerusalem and all the Jewish believers who were scattered. He says, the practical life starts when you receive Jesus, even though you know the law. And many of you who grounded in scripture know what he writes. Mary Magdalene, from a sinner into an apostle of gospel. Gospel means good news, if you don't know. It means good news. She was the first person who Jesus sent to tell his disciples that he was alive. She was the first person to meet Jesus after the resurrection. Jesus sent her to say that he was alive. Jesus said to her in John chapter 20, verses 16 and 18, Mary, he referred to her by name. He referred to her by name. He said, Mary. She turned and said to him in Arabic, Rabbani, meaning teacher. And then Mary Magdalene goes to his disciples and she says, I have seen the Lord. She doesn't say, I have seen Jesus. Now all of a sudden, all the sermons, all the times she spent with Jesus made sense. She professes with her mouth, I have seen the Lord. He is risen and he's waiting for you. Come quickly. He's waiting for you. So from a sinner to the person who proclaimed the good news of Jesus' resurrection, if you're a sinner today or you're not proud of your past, and even if you became a Christian but your past holding you back, let Jesus set you free of every life-controlling issue and be the messenger of good news. Say, Jesus, I am on a mission. I'm ready to tell others about how you set me free, and I want to set others free. So next Sunday, whenever we have water baptism, I want you to be that person who will proclaim to the world, to the spiritual and physical, and say, I am deciding to follow Jesus. I want to call him my Lord and Savior. I want to proclaim to the world that he's my Messiah and I have been redeemed. After she meets Jesus, post-resurrected, she realizes he's the Messiah. Now John, from ordinary nice guy to a leader. How many of you know it's not easy to be a leader if you're a nice guy? People don't want to listen to you. So you have to have more than just being nice. Firm helps. If you're nice and firm, it could come really handy. So what happened? When John met Jesus after his resurrection, his unwavering faith has made even stronger. He was always faithful to Jesus. But now he saw Jesus for who he is. But listen to what he says. He doesn't say, hey guys, you all fled, you all left Jesus. I am the only one who stayed with him at the cross. I saw him die, so I don't need forgiveness. I have done nothing wrong. Listen to what he says. 1 John 5, 11, 13. He says, this is the testimony. He says, this is my testimony that God gave us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have Son does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of Son of God, that you know that you have eternal life. He never mentions his friendship with Jesus. He says and confirms that the only way to have eternal life is to have person of Jesus. It's not following the rules and tradition of the church, this church or any other church. It's not reading your Bible constantly, even though it helps you to know about Jesus. But life comes to you and to me only through having person of Jesus Christ. And now let's go to Peter. From a rugged, it's all about me person, now he's becoming a caring leader. How does that happen? Peter was humbled. He was reassured in Jesus' love for him. He became a leader to a new church in Jerusalem. Yet when it came to give a testimony of his relationship with Jesus, here's what he says. Let's listen to his words. He says, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers. Now, those of you who brings baggage from the back, from your past, from your parents, from generation. He says, yes, you know that you've been redeemed, set free, even if your past is not your own fault. Not with perishable things such as silver or gold, meaning you cannot buy forgiveness or salvation, but with the precious blood of Christ. Like that of a lamb without blemish or spot, he talks about Old Testament offerings. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last time for the sake of you who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope are in God. He says, do not trust things that perish. Do not trust things that people come up with. The only way for you to know and have eternal life and your sins forgiven through the precious blood of Jesus. And today we're celebrating that. People just like Peter, just like rest of his friends, it not relying on his accomplishments or stuck on his failures. He's simply saying that his hope is solely on what Jesus has done for him on the cross.
That's what Easter is all about. Here, watch this video.
Next. File, please. Some lying, some stealing, and some acts of kindness here and there.
I tried to live a good life.
Well, let's see how good. This way. Next. File, please.
Okay, I admit it. I did a lot of bad things.
Yes, I see.
But I've done good things too, you know, to offset the bad things. Like one time I cheated on a test, but then I cleaned up trash in the park. That should balance out, right?
Let's find out. This way.
That should have balanced out, right? It should have balanced out.
Next. File, please. Impressive.
Oh, yeah. I devoted my entire life to make this world a better place. I dug wells in Africa. I donated blood every month. And I ran an orphanage in India. I mean, I just wish I could have done more.
And is this your subscription?
I only read the articles. I only read the articles.
Next.
My mom goes to church.
Was baptized as a baby?
Take American Express, right?
Next. File, please. Whoa. Somebody's been busy. Well, let's get this over with. Sorry, I didn't know he was with you. Okay, step on the scale. Not you. Him.
Hey, wait a minute. That is totally not fair.
That's why it's called grace. Next.
That's very little primitive illustration of what grace is. If you've done good, and without a doubt, we all do good, but the bad, we can't hide. I want Jesus to cover my bad. And it's not that he can cover my bad and just to accept my good. I want him to be on the scale when it comes for me to give an account. Because I put my trust by my faith in him, complete trust. I give him my life and I have his life. That's why I don't die. If you accept him as your savior, you don't die. Your life is not going to end in a casket. Just like Jesus, you will be resurrected for life to come. And that's something people have been just wondering through ages and generation, what happens after we die? I want to hear from a person who already died and then he was rose again. He rose again to tell me that if you believe in me, you will be with me. I have prepared an eternity for you. Now, grace of God is not something you can receive. And you would say, how is that possible? I thought it's possible to receive that. Redemption or forgiveness of our guilt come only in one person. Outside of Christ, you cannot have redemption and grace. If you want him, everything comes with him. If you don't want him, but just want his stuff, you want his righteousness, you want his good side, you want his redemption, it doesn't work that way. Tell me, married people, if you were looking for love outside of the person you married to, how does that end up for you?
Whenever we say, I'm looking for love, I want to be happy in my marriage, we're talking about a person, right? This person now is my lover. She's in my life. And outside of that person, my marriage is not happy. You cannot receive grace and redemption over your life if you reject the person of Jesus Christ. It's only possible, as John states so clearly, he says, and I want you to know that you have life in the Son of God. You have life if you have Jesus. If you don't have Jesus, Easter is nothing for you. You can't use Easter to cover your conscience, your religious conscience. If you receive Jesus, here comes resurrection. Here comes forgiveness of sins. Here comes righteousness. And then when it's time to be on that scale, it's not you who's going to be standing there. Because in Christ, that's what water baptism means. I symbolically tell into the world what happened. I died for myself and I am risen in Christ to go and walk in newness of life, in righteousness, but not of my own. Now it's Jesus who lives through me, and day by day we become more like him. If you look around and you say, hey, I don't know Christians who's like Jesus, they're still in process. We're all in process. And church is really, that's where we help each other. We're not to point fingers and say, hey, you're not right. Something's wrong with you. We're here to be Jesus for you and to say, hey, whatever your past is, we don't care. But we care that from now on, you go and you be victorious in life. You go on and you're going to be achiever in Christ. From now on, we're not going to point to your past. Your past will be forgiven, wiped out, and forgotten. We're going to look forward to walk with Christ, to spend it on eternity with him. He will represent you before the Father if you will accept him, because he's perfect, he's sinless, and he's risen. Hallelujah. He's risen. He's risen so we can have eternal life and we can have forgiveness. Now, I will ask you to just bow your heads and close your eyes, and I'm going to speak to you, and I really want to extend the invitation of Jesus to you. You're not coming to me. You're not confessing your sins to me, but you're coming to Jesus. He's interested in your life, as I showed you through four of his friends from different background, different past, but he was interested in them to make sure their future was different than was their past. Right now, if you find yourself not being sure where you stand with Jesus, have you accepted him? Have you ever personally, willingly, and verbally said, Jesus, I want you in my life. I don't want to just be free of sin and guilt and frustration. I want you in my life. I want to walk with you. I want to be with you in this life. Then today is the perfect opportunity for you. He's calling your name this morning. And he says, whatever your name is, John, Mary, Peter, James, whatever your name may be, I'm calling for you. I want to spend an eternity with you. I want you to have future with me. And when the day comes, I want to be responsible for your salvation. I want to be responsible that you have eternal life because you accepted Jesus. So right now, if you feel that it's you he's talking to, if you feel that it's you, I want you to raise your hand high. Don't be ashamed. Today is the day when you say, Jesus, I want to walk with you. I want to be associated with you. I want to call you my friend. Just like the people who surrounded Jesus called them his friends. He said, I'm not ashamed to call you my friends, because I gave my life for you, and I want your life to be different, to be new, to be transformed. So if you're that person, today is your time. Today is your time when Jesus tells, hey, I want to walk with you. I want to give you my authority. I want to give you my mission. Be on my team. I want to use your life for the greater glory of God. So name of Jesus would be made famous. So right now, as team starts to sing, I want you to just ponder on that. Just keep asking yourself. Just ask yourself, Jesus, is today my day? And he will definitely say, today's your day for you to respond and say, Jesus, I want to be your disciple. I want to follow you.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided. Jesus, no turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back.
To get up. And if you're that person who decided to follow Jesus, no matter what's ahead, but you know with Jesus, it's going to be fine. You're not going to get through life. You're going to get through situation. I want to give you an opportunity to come to the front. We're going to pray with you. We're going to give you a chance. We're going to help you. We're going to help you to get from where you are, whatever you are in your walk with Christ, or you never walk with Him. We're going to give you a chance to take your next step and be with Him. So right now, just come as we keep on singing. Be brave. Be bold. Don't be afraid. God has a plan for you.
No turning back. No turning back. The cross before me. The world behind me. No turning back. No turning back.
Let's give God a hand of praise. He is risen. He's the one who changed your life. Now, if you want to know more about our church, we want to connect with you. So come visit our Connect Center. Be plugged in. If you're a follower of Christ, which I assume all of you are, we want you to be plugged in. We want you to be serving. We want you to be growing in Christ, because ultimately, that's the reason we chose to follow Him, to know Him personally and to know Him better. Heavenly Father, we just praise Your name. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the precious gift of Jesus. Lord, we did not only receive forgiveness and love and compassion, we received Your Son as a gift, Lord. And I know our life so much better whenever we walk with Him closely, personally, know Him, whenever we can relate to Him and know that He's our King and Lord. Lord, we worship You today. We give You praise and honor, and we lift Your name because we're glad we know You, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah. God is worthy. Amen. Come on. Jesus Christ has risen. We have something to celebrate about. So let's put our hands together and give Him praise.
Risen. He's risen. Forever glorified. Risen. He's risen. King Jesus. King Jesus is alive.
Come on. thank you so much for coming out for the Easter service. Take some time, meet some new people, and hang out. Blessings.